I have notes on my phone, so I'm not ignoring you and texting you. I'm looking at notes. All right, everybody. I'm Ian Johnson. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Ian Johnson. I have a shop called Big Tire Garage and a couple TV shows that you've maybe seen. And that's what how I make my living, is basically building cool junk and drinking black coffee. This is Brian Lambert, also known as Rolling Bomb Fab, the expert of expert TIG welders. And he makes his living gluing stuff together as well. So what we're going to do today is we're going to talk about basics of TIG welding. So the first question I'm going to, who here would consider themselves proficient at TIG welding? One, get out. Wrong class. Come back later. Perfect. So we got a perfect class. Now we have some students in the crowd, right? Some students over here. I've met them already. Okay, guys. So basics of TIG welding. What we're going to do is just first we're going to talk about what is TIG welding. TIG welding is a very specific form of welding. The TIG obviously stands for tungsten inert gas welding. It's a form of gas tungsten arc welding. We can get into all of that, but since this is just the basics of the class, we're just going to cover some sort of do's and don'ts of TIG welding. And if you have any questions at any time, just shoot your hand up in the air and we'll talk about it. So I'm going to refer to my notes now to make sure I'm not missing anything from the good folks at weld.com that told me what I absolutely have to talk about in this class. So the first thing that we're going to cover is, I'm going to scroll all the way back. So we're going to talk about the advantages of TIG welding. So one of the biggest advantages of TIG welding is that it is good for both ferrous and non-ferrous material applications. Does everybody know what that means, ferrous and non-ferrous? Okay, great. For those of you that don't, that's the difference between steel, essentially, and aluminum welding. So the nice thing about the TIG welder is it can weld both, and it works great for all those applications. The other beauty of it is you'll get some very good bead appearance with the TIG weld versus MIG weld. MIG weld, you can get an excellent looking bead, but with the TIG weld, you can obviously make a lot better looking bead profile as you are welding. Disadvantages. So the disadvantages is it's a lot slower than MIG welding. Probably the biggest example I could give, I spend my life gluing together crazy rock crawling chassis and off-road trucks, and if I'm going to MIG weld a chassis together versus TIG weld a chassis, it usually takes three times as long to TIG weld that same chassis together. And the reason for that is the prep that has to go in to the weld, both pre and post. So when you MIG weld, you can just grab the gun, pull the trigger, start welding. When you TIG weld, you obviously have to clean the joint, remove any contaminants from the joint. If you're working with mild tubing or chrome moly like I do, it must be completely cleaned inside and out before we begin the welding process. We're going to talk a little bit about PPE, personal protective equipment you have to wear. Step on out here. Let's have a look at this guy. So as we see, this, even though when you're TIG welding, there may not be a bunch of sparks that are going to jump up and hit you, you obviously would still want to wear some nice long sleeve unless you want to get a sunburn. So proper PPE, obviously, leather gloves, long flame resistant shirt, helmet. If you don't have spiky hair, you can put on a little welding cap. I have the spiky hair, so I don't wear the welding cap. But you want to have the proper PPE, obviously, whenever you weld. And then depending on what the application is, you may actually end up wearing a respirator or some type of clean air system. Do you ever wear respirators when you're welding?
Yes, sir, every day.
What do you normally weld in when you're wearing that?
Aluminum.
So if you're doing a lot of aluminum, especially in an enclosed area, respirator or some type of fresh air supply, that'll keep any issues coming up. So before we go any further, we're going to jump straight into a little bit of welding. Jump on in there, my friend. Let's fire up our big screen into our super duper welding camera. Let's see if they hear it first. Knock on the wall. Here we go. All right, so we're going to start with basically a good bead. So jump in there, Brian. Let's rock down a bead. I'll talk them through it. So very simply, you're basically going to be pushing the torch. This is aluminum. You can see Brian is going to form the bead puddle on the material, and then he dips the filler rod into the molten puddle as he welds. That is the most important thing that you'll see people do incorrectly when they're learning how to TIG weld. So you're basically pushing the puddle forward with the torch. You're keeping the tungsten about an eighth to a sixteenth of an inch away, keeping the tungsten out of the puddle and adding the filler rod into the molten puddle, and then you end up with that beautiful bead. That's good weld right there, huh? You can clap for him, he's a good welder. All right, so seeing a good weld, now let's take a look at some common mistakes. So let's start with arc length too long and melting the filler before it gets into the puddle. So jump in there and do a nasty bead. So this is the most common mistake I think that I've ever seen the intro TIG welders do. As you can see, they're actually using the arc length to melt the filler instead of melting the base material and adding the filler into the puddle. This is a very common problem. This is going to lead to a poor quality weld. This weld will be full of porosity because obviously we did not weld the base material at all. So that is the word, that's not a good weld. This is not pretty, Not pretty at all. All right, we'll jump right now into the different setups of the machine. So now we've seen a good bead and a bad bead. And what Brian's welding at right now is he's using the 205 and he is welding at, how many hertz are you welding at, Brian? All right. So we're doing AC welding, and the nicest thing about the 205 is we can adjust the setup of the machine and we can adjust what's called hertz. Does everyone understand the basic premise of hertz when we're AC welding? Who doesn't? Put up your hand. Man, nobody wants to put up their hand. All right, so I'll cover it anyway. I'm not gonna wait for you to put up your hand. I'm gonna tell you. So hertz basically is the if you think of AC welding, we're AC welding on a sine wave, and we have a positive and a negative side of that sine wave. One side we're cleaning, one side we're welding. The more hertz, spend a lot more time in a 1 second period. So just for fun, Brian, you're gonna hit 400 hertz just for fun. All right, there we go, go for it. Okay, so as you can see, this is a 400 hertz. Every other setup is the same on the machine. You hear it sounds a lot different, that 400 hertz, that arc length's a little more concentrated now. Same process. You can see he's working his way through the weld and adding that filler to the front edge of that molten puddle. Probably the biggest difference is you can see the arc is a little bit tighter, and you can see, well, you can't see on this picture, but there's less burnout on the sides, a little light white flaky stuff that comes on the side. The bead profile can get a little bit thinner. Probably another benefit to TIG welding is the fact that we can actually work with different thicknesses of material a lot easier. So if you have to weld an incredibly thin piece of material to a thick piece of material, you have the ability to fully control that arc with the pedal while he's welding. So let's jump over to some steel. Let's do some stainless. Ready to do some stainless? Okay, as I said before, the nicest thing, one of the benefits of TIG welding is the fact that we can do ferrous and non-ferrous. So we're gonna jump out of AC, slide back down to DC. You're on the same 205, unless you want it thinner. You're good, okay? And that's the only setup that has to change, just on the machine itself. And now we'll do some stainless. Oh, hold on, Brian. I'm gonna move that. That looks good. Okay. So similar process to aluminum. Stainless, he's gonna be 16th to an inch, 1/8 of an inch away with the tungsten. I think I put you on DC. Scratch it and see if it. There we go. Okay, my bad. I didn't hit enter on the machine. Same process as aluminum, 16th to an 1/8 of an inch away. Exact same welding procedure. He's pushing that bead profile down the piece of stainless and then adding the filler. Most important thing when working with stainless is going to be gas coverage. Terrible, Brian. He's I'm sorry, buddy. You want less amperage? So exact same process as aluminum. Exact same process as aluminum. 16th to an 1/8 inch away. Push the puddle and then add the filler after that. I'm gonna check my notes. Any questions so far? Yes. Wait, I'm bringing you a mic. That's a very good question. I probably should have pointed that out. With the Rebel 205, with most TIG welders, you're gonna have basically foot control of the amperage. So we set this machine, Brian's got the machine right now set at 205. That is the max amperage that the machine will run at with the foot pedal all the way down. But as you're welding, you have full control over the amperage output of the machine with a foot pedal. You can see it right here. I'm gonna grab this. Basically a little gas pedal. As you push that down, you'll actually be able to increase or decrease the amperage. And you can watch the weld puddle. As the puddle starts to get too fat, especially on aluminum, if you do a lot of aluminum has a tendency to soak in a lot of heat. You'll actually see the weld puddle start to get real fat real fast. You can back off that amperage with the foot pedal. Another option is a thumb control that you can add to the machine to control amperage that way as well. So it's kind of like a dance, right? You've got all the power of the machine on your foot, and then you're filling it with your left or right hand, depending on which hand you are, and then controlling the torch with your right. Any other questions? Man, I thought that would just open the floodgates, man. All right, so now now that we've done some welding, let's kick it over to AC and we'll trash a tungsten, because we don't pay for them. Okay, so we showed you the proper way to TIG weld aluminum. We showed you a very common problem that people have when they pre-melt the filler. The other biggest problem that people make, let's do this. Let's just dip it first, and then we'll feed filler right into it. So just dip it so it kills the arc. So as I said before, you want to be 1/16 to 1/8 of an inch away. That's a super dip. That's right off the bat dip. When you get too close to that filler, too close to that molten puddle, and get the tungsten in it, the machine's just going to stop welding, 100%. If you're in the molten puddle pushing along, sometimes the machine will almost spit and sputter, almost like it's stalling. That'll tell you right away, you're too close. You're what's called licking the puddle. You're basically dragging the tungsten through that puddle. You're too close. Aluminum is fluid and flowy, and it'll just chase itself right up that tungsten if you get too close. All right, now what's that? Yeah, let's do one more. Run a little bit of a bead and just do that stutter stop thing type of deal. So you can hear the machine welding right now. You hear that little pressure. What he's doing at this point is he's licking the puddle with the tungsten. What's happening is that molten puddle is growing and it's gonna chase the heat. So if you get the tungsten too close, if you hear the machine start to stutter and stall, that means you're too close. You're licking that puddle with the tungsten. Every time you do that tungsten is now contaminated. It's gotta be pulled out, resharpened before you do it again. Telltale sign of that is you can see this black mark. If you're welding aluminum, you start to see that black mark show up. That means you basically contaminate that tungsten. Some guys will try to push through it, but that's not a good idea. Strip that sucker out and clean it up. And then finally, the biggest mistake people make is just feeding that filler rod right up into that tungsten, and I'll make Brian do that now. The reason this happens so often is as you're welding, all the heat is coming off that tungsten, and aluminum, when it flows, wants to follow the heat. So if you get that filler anywhere close to that tungsten, it's gonna suck right up onto the tungsten and you'll end up with a beautiful little tungsten Q-tip. The end of that tungsten, I don't know if you can see it right there, it's basically covered in aluminum. So at this point, you can't just sharpen your way out of this. Pull the tungsten out, break it off, resharpen it, and then you're good to go. That's a very common mistake because as you're filling that tungsten in, as that tungsten is being filled in, it's very easy to feed that filler rod in too far and it will just soak right up into that tungsten and it's contaminated. Any questions about TIG welding basics? Yes. Hold on, bring in your mic.
Okay, if I'm right-handed, what goes in my right hand, the torch or the rod?
Personally, I'm right-handed and I leave the torch in my right hand. Same with you? Yeah, most people I know, but I do know people that will sometimes flip it. In all honesty, it's just gonna be comfort. Most right-handers will end up with a torch in the right hand because what you're doing is you're basically steering the arc with that tungsten. Any other questions? All right, that's it. There we go. TIG welding basics, guys. Thank you very much.